Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to this edition of Disability Viewpoints. With me today is my co-host and friend, Joan Willshire. Welcome to the show, Joan.
Oh, thanks.
Who's your special guest today?
Oh, today was a fabulous guest, Ann Schulte from the Minnesota Department of Health, talking about the COVID vaccine and how people with disabilities and when will they be able to get the vaccine for COVID.
Sounds great. Mine is Maren Hulden. She's an attorney with the legal aid, but she's with the MNCCD, which is an important organization in the disability world. And she's gonna talk about a lot of things, the game plan for this year's legislature, some of the proposals they have, and there are about four. And they also have a new individual membership to people. It used to be just nonprofits and organizations,
great,
but a new individual membership coming up that they're gonna talk about. So it should be good, and we're looking forward to that right next on Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned. Hi, Maren Hulden is our special guest today from MNCCD, and she's going to talk a little about the legislative agenda that they have and some proposals for this year, and also some single member ships for MNCCD that are new. And so, Maren, welcome to the show. And I'll let you take it away from here. And any background information you want to tell us about yourself, go right ahead. You're up.
Sounds good. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me, Mark.
You're welcome.
It's a real privilege to be here. I'm Maren. I am an attorney at Legal Aid, which includes the Minnesota Disability Law Center. And through that work, I have, I'm fortunate enough to be serving as one of the two policy co-chairs. As our policy committee does every year, we invite our members to submit proposals for us to put on our collective shared agenda for the upcoming legislative session. And, you know, it's one of the great things that I love about being policy co-chair is just every year our members bring such important and thoughtful policy proposals. And it makes it a really enjoyable process to get to talk through all of these wonderful ideas that different organizations have about how to improve the lives of people who have disabilities across Minnesota. And this year we, you know, there's a lot going on in the world in 2020.
That's for sure.
And we kind of took a step back and we actually formed in June, we formed an anti-discrimination committee that focused both on how to make sure that people who have disabilities aren't discriminated against in COVID relief, and then also to look at how we can advance racial equity in our work as MNCCD too. And as a result of the leadership from that committee, our whole policy committee adopted four policy principles that have kind of undergirded all of our work this session. And those are, one, creating an equitable, accessible, safe, and just society. Two, promoting diversity, inclusion, and equity. Three, improving and protecting essential supports and services. And four, supporting individual empowerment and choice. And we kind of think of them all together as under this broader understanding that when we do things together, we do better. And so
Absolutely.
We are all better together.
Absolutely. The governor recently announced the deficit in the state of Minnesota. And what's different about that is in February, March, when the legislature shut down, we had a surplus.
Yeah.
And so how much harder do you think it's going to be able to get your proposals through with the deficit now that we didn't have before?
I think that a lot of our budget picture as a state is really going to depend on what other sorts of funding may come in from the federal government, which I think really remains to be seen.
You're exactly right, and that was my thought. And that's my next worry is with all the damage that was recently done in Washington, D.C., and all the COVID action that needs to be taken swiftly for the disability issues, how fast will we get our federal money? How much will we get? How much will be cut back? You know, and I'm not trying to be negative, but I think a lot of us in the real world about that. And that's why on normal times we would be down at the Capitol and State Office Building, because you always have that worry. And
yeah.
So what are What do you think are the pros and cons of your proposals?
Yeah, so to the first principle about creating an equitable, safe, and just society, one proposal is around ensuring different types of accessibility in different aspects of government. So we have there's a long history, well, it's becoming a long history of the Americans with Disabilities Act, which ensures a lot of accessibility, but our folks we work with are discovering that there's other types of accessibility that folks need, like sensory accessibilities. And so the Autism Society has been leading on several bills to make sure that, large public events or the special education process or courts are accessible to people who have sensory issues.
Right.
Another bill is about for people who have traumatic brain injuries,
right,
making sure that they have the opportunity to have a neuropsychological exam before being sentenced, which can help make sure that they get access to the supports that they need, even that they may need to kind of recover from, whatever brought them to the place of committing the crime that they've been charged with. Another bill under this topic is about making sure that people who have rare diseases have flexibility within their health insurance about which providers they can go to, because we know that sometimes it can be very challenging with extremely rare diseases to find a provider who really has the expertise to help folks manage their illness. So that's the first principle. The second, our second principle about promoting diversity, inclusion, and equity, we have four bills under this principle. And the first one is one that folks have probably heard of before, and it is just so important that we are working arm in arm with lots of other folks continuing to push for it, which is a PCA rate framework. We know that our PCA program in Minnesota has been years underinvested. The rates have not caught up with overall wages,
right,
and there's an extreme workforce shortage. And so we're looking this year to establish a framework so that the department has the information they need about how to have a rate framework that is responsive and changes over time based on the economy. Another proposal here is that 2 years ago, we advanced legislation to create a rare disease advisory council. We want to make a change to how it's governed so that it can make policy, do policy advocacy on its behalf. We also are looking to expand the definition of brain injury to make sure that it includes people who have acquired a brain injury because of prenatal fetal alcohol exposure. And that's one that has been with us before, and it, like many of these, it doesn't have a price tag. It may not have a price tag, and so that's a theme that you may hear throughout, based on related to your question about budget. We also will support the SEIU, which is the union that
PC
Choice and CDCS and Consumer Support Grant Workers are part of, to get their contract ratified.
They worked hard to get that started, and I'm glad you're supporting that.
Absolutely. As far as improving and protecting essential supports and services, this is such an important principle, especially in this time, as you note, because we don't really, we are going to work super hard to make sure that there aren't rollbacks to the supports and services that people already have access to. So one is a bill to establish a license for board certified behavioral analysts, which would help, ensure quality across the board and create clear pathways to that very needed profession. Another is, and this has come up a lot during COVID, is about getting DHS to work with stakeholders to figure out how to allow PCAs and direct service professionals to continue working with the person who they work with, even if that person is hospitalized. Because Medicaid before wouldn't allow, you to pay a PCA in addition to paying for your hospitalization, but we know that people who have disabilities often need that support worker in the hospital. And then finally, to support individual empowerment and choice, we are advancing with partners a bill to, that we call it the Systems Transformation Bill, to really advance these policy priorities that the legislature passed last year around employment, independent living of people's choosing, and self-direction for people who have disabilities. And so we want to build on that.
Right. Have you met with the governor?
We have met with DHS many times. We haven't met with the governor himself directly, although he did come to the event that we co-hosted with the State Council on Disabilities in December. and was very receptive to what we what he heard from our members.
That's good news. I didn't mean to cut you off when you were talking there before. Did I miss anything?
One more, actually, that is interesting that you ask about the governor, because this is one that we raised with him. He did a small group roundtable with MNCCD last January, and this is one that we really thought he liked based on that conversation. And this is about reinstating community access for the PCA program. Right now, PCAs can't bill while they're driving their client, and we want to change that to make sure that people have more access to the community.
Great. I want to do the final word segment of the show, and that's where we might have missed something that you wanted to say, or you can say anything you want. So it's kind of Maren Hulden unplugged, so go right ahead.
Well, honestly, the first thing that comes to mind is that a big change for MNCCD, in addition to, you know, our focus on racial equity, is that we want to be more inclusive of all people throughout the community, and so we have changed our bylaws to allow individual people to join.
Right. But anything else you want to say before we go?
No, just, you know, one thing is that this session presents so many challenges for getting people's voices heard at the Capitol.
Right.
But there are some opportunities, as you said earlier, and it is easier for people for whom it's hard to leave their homes, easier for people in greater Minnesota to have their voices heard.
Right.
And we would love to hear from you as MNCCD for how, if someone's facing something that one of our policy priorities would help you, we would love to hear from you, and we would work to, you know, record a video or find a chance for you to tell your story at the Capitol, even in this.
Again, info@mncd.org.
Yep.
Very good. And we're gonna have to leave it there, but we'll have you on again, and thank you for being on the show.
Sounds good. I look forward to it. Thanks again for having me.
Yeah, it was fun. Thank you for being on here.
All right.
A good day,
bye.
Maren. Bye now. Maren Hulden from MNCCD. We'll be right back with more of Disability Viewpoints.
My name is Joan Willshire, and I'm your co-host today. We know people with disabilities are struggling during this COVID-19 pandemic. They're struggling with putting on masks. They're struggling with that social distancing. They're isolated. And as a result, many are suffering depression too. And now, of course, everyone is wondering, when and where will we get this COVID-19 vaccine? With me today to discuss these issues is an individual from the Minnesota Department of Health. And with me is Ann Schulte, who is currently deployed from the Culture, Faith, and Disabilities Communities branch of the Minnesota Department of Health COVID Response Team. So, welcome, Ann.
Thank you so much. Thanks for including me in this.
Great. Well, the good news is we've got two vaccines out there helping us trying to get rid of, or at least slow down, this pandemic. So let's start with the good news. So we can say yay for that. So does the Department of Health here in Minnesota have some kind of plan just for people with disabilities besides your phase one and two that they have for the general public?
It's such a great question, Joan, and I wish I could tell you the exact answer. It just has been very stressful because, as you know, as we all know, there has been a limited number of vaccines available to all of us across the state. So we're working with, in fact, on behalf of the disability communities, we're contracting with six of the independent living across the states, as well as some of the services for the blind, who are helping us to share all this information, get the information out as quickly as we can. And we keep saying boots or wheels on the ground. They're the ones out there really working with us to ensure that people are getting vaccinated. The bottom line, though, is that, as I mentioned, we're very limited on the number of vaccines at this time. And we're trying to be as equitable as possible, so trying to be fair. And what they're really looking at to start with, because where do you really start, is they're looking at the people who have the most exposure. So as you mentioned, Joan, there are people living in residential settings that unfortunately are not prioritized at this very moment because they're living in their homes. However, that being said, the 65 plus are now we're working hard to vaccinate them. So it's been, as Ku Tao always says, it's like we're flying the plane as we're building it. So it's different every day. This afternoon, it might be different.
Right. Well, that's a challenge then for everybody, it sounds like. Do we know what other states are doing in regard to people with disabilities?
We have been looking a lot across the other states and have been doing a lot of work on what the most, Minnesota has been very clear to be as equitable as possible. So we want to ensure that all of the priority population's needs are being met. Just the fact that MDH has now got this community, this group of people that working specifically on disabilities has been great. Just as you all know, accessibility is huge. I think a great example was when testing came out, just it knocked on our door and the first thing was, let's get it out there. And as you all know, we had to then address accessibility.
Right.
So working very hard on that. So as we continue to work with some of our partners, the Council on Disability, we work across the state with other councils on independent living. We're working with ADA, working everyone we can to ensure that accessibility is there and it's never a barrier, so that anyone that needs to get the vaccine can have the vaccine.
Right. Well, that's fabulous. So you've mentioned some good groups, the Centers for Independent Living, the seven sites throughout the state. That's fabulous because they work right directly in their community. And so that's a fabulous way to be able to get to them. You know, the question has been, are the people with disabilities that are living now independently, are they going to be kind of forgotten about and not signed up right away to get the vaccine because they're not in kind of a system or a facility?
We feel pretty confident. We're really fortunate that we've been able to partner with the the Centers for Independent Living, because as you mentioned, they're across the state. Oftentimes we forget about, you know, greater Minnesota and some of the rural communities. And the wonderful thing about having the centers is that they can go out and determine what the needs are in the community. So many of them are helping each person that's living in their home to get a test. So it might be providing broad tablets so that they can take the saliva test. It might be helping them to read if they're blind and they can't read the screen readers. So it's just been a number of things across the state. One provider, one of our contractors said that they found out that the way that they could help a person with disabilities was that to provide them with firewood to ensure that she could stay warm because she had lost her job and she wanted to stay at home and not get exposed to COVID. So the ways that they've touched the community has really been wonderful to hear. And as you know, there's a very huge population out there, so it's gonna take time, but we're trying our best to do this.
Great, well, interesting story. Let's talk a little bit about testing. So do we know, do people with disabilities have the same opportunity and places to get testing in the state right now?
Yes, that's something we've been working really hard, and that's been a little bit easier. But again, keep in mind that testing's been around a little bit longer than the vaccination. But, you know, we found that many people, we heard a really sad story about a gentleman who went in to get tested. He was blind, get tested, and he couldn't read the screen reader because they weren't accessible. They have to lock the tablets at the sites. So.
Sure.
Was asking for someone to help him, and they said, well, and this was after he had attempted to get several tests. He finally made it to the location after addressing the barriers of transportation, and I know I don't have to share these with you, but then when he got there, no one could help him.
Oh, no.
So nowhere in the book does it say, well, you have to do this, because it's more than just compliance. It's just disability etiquette, and we're working hard, in fact, to create some sort of training so that every testing site and every vaccination site, as they get trained to administer the vaccine or the test, they'll have a quick video and some bullet points on how to make it accessible to all.
Great. Wow. This is so very interesting to learn about the ins and outs and just trying to do the basics of disability etiquette. And then the accessibility piece. Now, I know just in this last week also, they've set up these beyond the testing sites also where people will get the vaccinations. So do we know how accessible those places are going to be?
You know, since we have a little bit more time, we are definitely, one of our priorities is to ensure that it will be accessible to all.
Right, right. Now, also, when we're looking at the vaccine rollout, I know initially some states have raised the age around 75 or in the 70s, and I know isn't ours in the state of Minnesota still around 65?
Yes, yes, that's right.
What can you talk about in terms of age and guidelines for the vaccine rollout?
You know, that's a really hard question to answer because it's changing, as I mentioned, it's changing every moment. And this morning on a call, I did hear that we were trying hard. In fact, I'm sure that all of you have heard that today started a new process for 65 and older, where they could actually get tested. Maybe even we had some designated sites where they could be tested. But the reality is we're still actually in the beginning and still ensuring that the 1A people are getting vaccinated. We want to make sure that all the people in long-term care are getting vaccinated, the frontline workers. And as you can imagine, when you start to think about frontline workers, as we know now, teachers and those working closely, well, then we start to think of PCAs and people working in homes.
Right.
So it just, there's no one answer. We just have to keep kind of going forward and hope that we can.
Right. What can you tell me also about the new model for community outreach that MDH has had now, too?
So we have been working hard. We're calling them CCCs, Community Coordinator, or Community COVID Coordinator. So we're engaging communities across the state to address all different needs. So we've got, you know, Latinx, we've got African American, we've got disabilities, we've got faith communities, we've got all these different communities that of course are all, you know, looking for answers for their own situation. And we in our small disability group know that disabilities doesn't, it can reach across, it doesn't discriminate against anyone, right?
Right.
That's where it's been really interesting for us to get involved with all the different communities. We have weekly calls in which we have our disability community coordinators sharing some of the work they're doing. And they're working very hard to say, hey, we're here in you know, greater Minnesota. We can help you with any accessibility issues or reach the people with disabilities.
Right. So, well, what can we do moving forward and tell the people with disabilities? Is there a phone number, a website, something we can leave everybody today with some sort of action they can take if they're concerned and worried about when and where can I get the vaccine for COVID-19?
Yes, we do have a very interactive website right now. So if you go to the Department of Health's website and pull up the vaccine, there's many different, there's a vaccine dashboard that's real time. We're also, there's FAQ that's very helpful where you might be able to get it.
And give us that website for the Department of Health in Minnesota.
Yes. Department of Health at minnesota.gov/COVID-19/vaccine. And then from there it goes on there.
Well, we're just about out of time. Your last few moments, do you want to share anything else?
There's one more thing. If you go to the Minnesota State, the www.health.state.mn.us, it's so long. We do have a designated spot on the Centers for Health Equity page where we're trying to address needs for the disability community.
Okay.
So please feel free to go to that link. And if there's things that come up, please don't hesitate to reach out to us because we're here. We need to hear from all of you.
Great. Well, thanks so much, Ann, for bringing us up to date on where we're at with the COVID-19 vaccine for people with disabilities. And I'm sure it's ever-changing, so we'll perhaps have you back as we continue to wind down and get the rollout for our vaccine for COVID-19. Thanks so much.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thanks for including us. Have a great day.
That was a quick half hour with a lot of information. Joan Willshire had Ann Schulte on COVID-19 information. I had Maren Hulden from the MNCCD that talked about four proposals that the state legislature being proposed this year and single memberships. Joan?
Yes, we had a fabulous guest today from the Minnesota Department of Health talking specifically for people with disabilities on the vaccine for COVID-19, where to go and when it's going to be coming. It's still a lot of questions, but we did get some good information to start off with.
Good, and if I may, please watch your local news nightly and read the local newspapers, because that information does change just
Absolutely.
About every day. So again, for Joan Willshire and the entire team here at SPNN, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching, and bye for now.